very early on when we decided that the main character was going to be a jazz musician, there was this real commitment to a certain specificity and authenticity of musicianship, which, you know, a lot of people wonder when you pitch a movie like Soul, would kids be into it? And the main reason why I don't think we were ever really concerned is because we knew that if we presented the music performed in the dynamic way that jazz music is performed, that kids would lean into it. You know what I mean? In the same way that all of us leaned in watching Sesame Street or Tom and Jerry, kids actually have a very visceral, natural connection to music. I know I did. And I mean, I'm assuming John did too. I mean, that's why he's here today, is because even before you know what it is, music connects to you.
Yes, music in the film is a character. And the album, it has so many great moments and the arrangements, being able to have Roy Haynes play, who literally is, you know, he's one of the inventors of the craft, able to Charlie Parker and Louis Armstrong, 95, you know, to play drums. That's just a gift in and of itself, that I think you really hear that come across on the album, in that lineage, in that history of Black music and Black culture being represented in such an incredible story. You know, the story in and of itself is like, it's almost a new mythology. And Joe is a new mythological character. I know a lot of Joe is based on you, Kemp, in that barbershop scene. Just to have that in the same movie as a Roy Haynes drumming soundtrack in jazz music. You got Mingus, you got Monk, you have all of this stuff in that, a character like Dorothea. It's just, I mean, I get emotional just thinking about what that means.
I mean, the impact of it, it's been so funny watching, like Jamie is a great example, you know, because when we first brought Jamie in for his first recording sessions, you know, it's impossible to know what we're doing. You know, we give him a few lines. There's no animation yet. There's no music. It's just kind of like, what the hell is this movie? So there's a great satisfaction when people see the finished product, seeing the look on their faces like, oh, man, we did that. And it really is. It's the type of thing that, like, you don't get a lot of opportunities in your career to really pour yourself into something on this scale. I should say on this scale, because we're talking like a Disney Pixar film is the same scale as a Star Wars movie. Like, let's be completely real about it. And to be able, so many people to be able to pour their personal joy into something like this and have it just come out and wash over people, it really, I got to say, like, it was a real special Christmas. Let's put it that way, because it was really strange, man, to hear from people I haven't heard from in decades. You know what I mean? And I'm sure the same thing happened to you, John, where people were just like, hear from people I didn't even know how they got back in touch with me.
Right. Man, the phone was blowing up. It was crazy. It was crazy. Everybody, for the next week after Christmas,
yeah,
up until through the New Year's, people just kept discovering the film, people watching the film and sending me screenshots of their whole family in tears. There's so much. There was so much going on in the world, obviously, last year leading up to that point too, especially for Black people.
Yeah.
And just to see the way that aspect of the film spoke to people, the aspect of culture.
Yeah. And it was powerful. Musicians loved it. You know what I'm saying? Like,
right.
I love the fact that musicians keyed in on the fact that Joe's goal wasn't to be in a jazz band with a lead vocalist. The fact that it was an instrumental band, even that was kind of a bold choice.
Right, right.
Because you know that, like, there's limits to being in just an instrumental band. Like, okay, well, you're never going to play the Barclay Center, I guess. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you're automatically making his Joe's goal something much more humble.
I love that. It's about the art.
He
wanted to pursue the craft.
Yeah.
He was trying to portray that in the first scene when he was teaching the middle school band. He can't turn it off. He's the person that is constantly thinking about the craft. It matches, though. It matches to have it be an instrumental band because his temperament is that way.
And I gotta give you a lot of credit, John, because have you ever seen the TV show Ted Lasso? I'm just curious, John. Have you seen
No. What's that?
Oh man, it's this great comedy with Jason Sudeikis where it's about like a soccer coach, American, who goes and coaches a soccer team in Europe. And everyone in Europe is so negative, but he's like so earnest and positive that his positivity wins over all the negativity of the people. Spoiler alert, he wins over like everyone in Europe by the end. And that's the best description of like Jon Batiste on Soul. You know what I mean? Where when John showed up, you're sitting there going like, this guy can't be this into it. You know what I mean? Like there's a, I gotta give you credit, man. Like, and it's, it may be, maybe it's like a New Orleans thing because I like, that's the reason why I love going to New Orleans so much, because it's a city that's had a lot of challenges, but I find that as a people, there is a genuine, like, happy for what you got type, you know, thing that permeates the whole city. It's not a cynical town. Let's put it that way. You know, like, I remember one of my earliest trips to New Orleans, you know, I ran into a homeless man and he asked me for some money and I didn't have any. And I was like, I'm sorry, man, I don't have any money. And the homeless guy said, what are you sorry for, young man? I did this to myself. And he laughed and walked off. And I was like, wow, that's New Orleans for you. Like, people just.
I love that.
And John's, like, earnestness from day one, you kind of, like, when we brought him in, it was like, wow, this guy is bringing, like, a positivity that I think really, infect is the wrong word because that has a negative connotation. I'd say a positivity that really permeated everything that we were doing, and it makes it a lot easier to have a certain amount of tunnel vision and shut the world out, which is what you need to do when you're trying to tell a story that feels so unusual. You know, so that was a, you know, that the positivity and the passion of Joe, in many ways, we always say, like, it really does just represent what the energy we were getting from you, John.
Well, that's great to hear, because I was so excited about the idea. The idea is amazing. Think about this idea. Now that it's in the world, it's hard to perceive somebody saying to you that the film is about a jazz musician who goes between the two worlds, the spirit realm and earth. And the score is this split between this ethereal electronic music and jazz, modern contemporary jazz. That, to me, is a dream come true. For that to be made, and not only for it to be made and have the energy, that positivity, and that life in the film, in the feeling, in the ethos of the film, but for it to be made at the highest scale possible, Disney Pixar. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? It's not an indie film.
Right, right.
That's incredible.
I mean, can you talk a little bit about, because the jazz itself is something that's really interesting, because, I mean, all of us, of course, we grow up and we, you know, we learn to love, you know, the bebop era. You know, no one doesn't love Miles Davis. No one doesn't love Charles Mingus, Thelonious Monk. But I'm a Gen Xer. So for me, like, my real intro into casually enjoying jazz was more like Kenny Kirkland, Branford Marsalis. You know what I'm saying? It was more like the early 90s. And I think that for this film, it was interesting because I feel like, I guess jazz is still around and it's going in some interesting places. I think not just of you, John, but I think of like Kamasi Washington, you know what I'm saying? I think of like Robert Glasper.
Yes.
And I love the fact that you just like, you tried to do something that felt both accessible, but also new, you know, and fresh, as opposed to just mimicking the very familiar, the most familiar elements of jazz that we all know.
Absolutely. I think that if you're going to show jazz to a new generation, it's important for it to be rooted in the past in some way, but for it to reflect the now, most importantly. And that's the thing about having the opportunity to use the film as this introduction that I really took to almost like a responsibility to say that whatever we make has to be thoroughly of now, of today. And that feeling is what makes jazz so special. It's literally the thing that's happening right as you're watching it, right in front of you. It's the most modern art form because it's happening a millisecond at a time. Mm-hmm. It's being created brand new every single time. You can play the same song and it's created brand new every single time. So to capture that spirit of surprise and spontaneity was really the goal, because then it won't sound staid, or it won't sound archaic or like a historic retelling. It will sound like Joe is literally getting into the zone right in front of you, and you don't know how, but the magic of it draws you in. That's what I wanted to do. I remember moments where, you know, we didn't have a script or a cut of the film when we were scoring the music. And I remember moments where making music based upon a scene that I hadn't seen, coming to the studio, playing the composition that had been demoed out and written out, and the musicians are there, and changing the composition while in the studio before moving to the next cue. That was something that happened pretty regularly, which required the musicians to come in and have a jazz mindset, even though it was a film score. Mm-hmm. And I think that feeling of being nimble in that way to match the way that the narrative evolved over time was really very much like jazz. You know, the melody and the theme is there, but it can be spread out or adjusted or shifted depending on who you're playing with or what it needs to be for the film. And I love that. I really enjoy that. I hope that more films adopt that approach, because I think it really makes the music such a part of the fabric of the film. It's not an accoutrement. It's not it's not icing at the end that you put on the top of the cake. It's woven in, and I think that made it that much more of a potent experience, both musically and from the narrative perspective.
Yeah, I mean, it really did. Your role did seem to evolve, you know, over time. Because when you first came on board, I mean, it was very specific. It was like, okay, John's going to do the arrangements so that whenever Joe is performing, that's John's music. But it pretty quickly evolved into just like, here's a moment in the film. You know, what do you think of this? And the next thing you know, John is performing cues that have nothing to do with the performance, which is why, you know, the end result of the score really is this unique fusion of what, you know, John did and what Trenton Atticus did. Because I think in both cases, the folks that we, you know, both with John and with Trenton Atticus, like we brought them in, but we asked both sides to be much more collaborators in the story, in the way that we told the story, than I think anyone really anticipated, you know. And that was one of the most enjoyable elements of the film for me, at least, because, you know, we're stressing out, you know, breaking story and writing the thing and recording the thing, and getting an opportunity to kind of hear some new music laid down is usually one of those moments where it's like, oh, okay, I feel like we might have something now, because, you know, when we finally get some of that temp score out and get some of that temp music out and get the real stuff in, you know, it starts feeling like our film.
Right. That's it. That was even in the approach of doing arrangements that turned into cues. That was a moment of just discussion and improv between all of us. Because there were moments where there would be a piece by Coltrane or something in the temp, and I would suggest, which ended up being the norm, but, you know, suggesting, well, what if the temp was not, what if we didn't do a composition by Coltrane, but we took some of the spirit of that and found a way to bring it into today and bring it into Joe's world more specifically. Mm-hmm. And that's where a lot of the original compositions originated from at the beginning of the process, which is, you know, temp music that wasn't quite right, but there was something in it that we wanted to keep.
You actually studied jazz at Juilliard, right, John?
Mm-hmm.
there's no nice way to ask this, so I'm just going to straight up ask it. Were there a lot of black kids in your class, or were you like one of only like a couple? Because I've heard, I've read that like jazz as an art form at the academic level is now not being pursued as much by black kids. One of the great ironies that it's our community's creation, but then at the academic professional level, you're seeing fewer and fewer. So I'm just curious to hear your thoughts on that. Like, what was your experience?
My experience, you know, there were a few of us. There wasn't the majority, but there were a few of us at Juilliard. You know, my man Wynton Marcellus is running that program over there, and it's a very small program. So in relation to the rest of the school, at the time when I started, it was just getting started. Like, I moved to New York when I was 16, 17 to go to Juilliard from New Orleans. And I came from an environment where it was mostly black to being in a small 10 to 15 person program where only 10 or 15 people are in every year. So maybe two or three people get in per year. And that means that out of the 15, there was probably three or four of us that were black.
Wow.
And then within the school of 500 or 600, you can imagine, you know, talking about classical, dance, drama, you know, we were the minority at this time. Now, that's changed a bit, and I don't know how much it's changed at Juilliard, but back, I'm talking about like 07, 08, you know, it was definitely a culture shift. Now, you know, you got people from all over the globe with many different musical experiences and artistic experiences, and most of them are not familiar with the kind of swag that somebody, you know, a black kid wearing baggy clothes from Kendall, Louisiana, talking in a certain way, saying, huh, where you at, huh, what's am? You know, a certain kind of a flair that I had that, you know, if you don't have meaningful relationships with somebody like that in your formative years and you don't see that kind of person in media, then how do you relate to this person? Especially if they're saying, I just wrote a symphony and they in Lincoln Center and they're like, can you play my symphony? So it just, you know, there was a lot of, for many years for me, as coming from the cultural milieu that I came from, it was like, who is this? What's happening? Like, it was a question.
Yeah. I mean, conversely though, how was it for your family? Because obviously you come from a musical family. Well, a place where, like, you know, you have some, you know, really respected musicians in your family who didn't need to go to Juilliard. So, like, how did they react to your desire to kind of go that route, considering, you know, where you're from?
Man, my family, the lineage going back, I would say even seven generations, is truly the American dream. We're just the quintessential Americans in that, you know, my grandfather's the first one to move to Louisiana on both sides, grandparents. And before that, we're Mississippi. I have four generations of black family farmers in Georgia going back, you know, then going to Reconstruction after slavery. And my uncle Paul was the first person to get a degree in music out of, you know, his six brothers, my dad included, who also went to college for music, was the first to go to college for music. And my uncle was the first to get a degree and teach music. And they all mostly stayed in Louisiana. And there was some other parts of the Batiste lineage, like Harold Batiste, who produced Sonny and Cher, and Patti LaBelle, you know, Alvin Batiste, avant-garde clarinetist. He started a band with Ellis Marcellus that brought avant-garde music to New Orleans. And they taught all of the musicians from Branford, Wynton, they taught all the musicians of the last 50 years of New Orleans music, myself included, being the last generation of that. So I had that pedigree, but they were really proud of the fact that, wow, somebody after seven generations can go to New York as a kid and make a name for themselves and go to Juilliard and get a master's degree. It's not that I needed to go. It's the fact that I could go. And the fact that it was something of a milestone for the family. They were like, you get to go up there and you get to study orchestration and collaborate with the drama division and write a ballet and all these different, you can go and write a musical, you can be on Broadway. it was just, this had never happened for our family. We were always in a specific cultural setting, and it just broke, it broke open a lot in terms of our lineage. And it took seven generations
to
get there. You see what I'm saying? It's incredible to think about it in that way, I think.
For me, Soul is a movie about life and passion that I feel the lucky thing about it is we get to tell this universal story through the specific prism of a Black man. You know, when you get to tell a story through a character that you feel not only represents you, but represents like so many people who are like you. It was a real balancing act, and I'm so proud of the final result. And yeah, I mean, I'm definitely gonna do it again, but again, it's important for people to understand how hard this work is. It's not like, oh yeah, I'm finished with Soul, let me go right back and do another damn Pixar movie, because you know, you need to take a little break after when you land these types of planes. You need to kind of like go and rest your brain a little bit, because it's really quite a thing. But again, I feel really lucky in that I feel like maybe I was just like the right guy for the right time, you know what I mean, and in terms of like the specific voice that I have, which in the past with other projects has been a detriment, you know, because I have very specific beliefs and I have very strong opinions and write particular types of characters. This is one of those unique situations where it was actually an asset. And I hope that, like, you know, I think the end result is evidence of everyone contributing to this whole that was greater than all of us, you know, from me and John to, of course, you know, Pete, Doctor, and Dana and Mike, you know, to Jamie and Anne, like everyone put Questlove, like everyone put some of themselves into this film. You know, like John said in the beginning, he was like, a lot of Joe, a lot of my life influenced writing Joe. But the reality is, I think everyone involved could say that Joe represents elements of their lives, you know, like like very specific elements. We all, you know, so when people watch the film, they're like, oh yeah, little kids are gonna like 22, but adults are gonna like Joe. That's not necessarily the case. Little kids relate to Joe. Like everybody relates to Joe. Because I think that's the end result of everyone putting themselves into that character. So it's really been something, man. Good to see you, John.
Yeah, as always, man.